Okay, so the plan for today is to return to this topic that we briefly talked about sometime a week or so ago, because this idea of using Fourier transform to solve differential equations. And I wanted to, in particular, show you this thing that's in the notes under the section under the title "Fundamental Solutions," which is a sort of more advanced application of using Fourier transforms to solve differential equations. Hopefully, it'll go okay. There are some sort of messy estimates and so on that we have to make in the middle of this group, and it's possible that we will all become unhappy about this. There's also a little bit of contour integration here. And I remember last time I asked, some people had done complex analysis, but many people hadn't. Can you remind me again how many people have done the complex analysis course? Okay, so maybe what we'll actually do today as well is just like the 5-minute crash course in complex analysis, so that those of you who haven't taken this course don't need to anymore. not quite, but we can at least remember the really important. The thing that I wanted to ask you guys about as well is something I'm a bit indecisive about for this course. So what we are going to do basically starting on Friday is all the abstract measure theory part of this course. And there are essentially two different approaches which we could take, and I'm still not sure what we should do as on Friday. One is to follow what's in the notes at the moment, and which is pretty close to what's in Stein and Shikaki, which is pretty close to what's in Terry Tao's book on measure theory as well, which is a sort of pretty conventional approach. We set up what it means to be a measure space and all this stuff. We describe how you build measures using exterior measures and pre-measures and all these other gadgets, and then we go and do some integration theory. The other possibility is to take a sort of more abstract view of measure theory. And instead of defining measures, define integrals, and only later pull out of those what a measure is. Now, the advantage of doing it this way is I think that it's actually a more beautiful way to think about measure theory. In some sense, it's conceptually simpler. But it is a bit more abstract. And I sort of want to leave it to you guys to tell me which route we should take. A disadvantage of doing it the more abstract way is that I would have to put a bit more time in preparing than I would have to put in preparing for the standard way. But I also know that the standard way is not the most exciting part of the course, and it might actually be more interesting to see the more abstract approach rather than redoing what we did in analysis 2 in slightly more generality. Does anyone have opinions? Can we have a vote, something like that?
The less abstract way is more freely available for us to read in our own time. So maybe seeing the more abstract way would possibly be.
Any other?
I agree with that.
Looking over the notes, it was very much throwback to analysis too. It seems like it's less.
And also, we could. There's like heaps of material on it as well that like Stein and Tao that we already have seen.
Okay, great. So in that case, as of Friday, who knows what's going to happen? but I'll try and tell you about integrals instead of about measures. There are promises. Okay, so let's do what we want to do today. So just to remember what we basically talked about already. If you're solving some differential equation that looks like this, so here, f is some fixed function, u is the function we're trying to solve for this differential equation. And this here, d is our differential operator with that minus I in front of it. And p is just meaning some polynomial in partial derivatives. Okay, it might be a multivariate polynomial if we're working in Ra. Okay, how are you meant to solve this? Well, you just take Fourier transform of everything. And remember that Fourier transform converts derivatives into multiplications by coordinates. We just get that very easy equation. Now this is just a polynomial in coordinates multiplied by this guy. And if p of xi doesn't vanish, which is, a big assumption, then you can just move it over. remember that you can then turn the inverse Fourier transform of a product into the convolution of the inverse Fourier transforms. And so the whole problem basically comes down to computing this particular inverse Fourier transform. And then for any given f, it's easy to pull out a solution to this differential equation. It's just convolution of this magical function associated to our polynomial with the whatever the right hand side, that's the homogeneous term of the differential equations. And I guess I think we talked about the heat equation and solving the heat equation by basically using this approach a few days ago. And that's at the end of this section of notes. But now let's go back into the first half of this section of notes. And I want to show you how this idea pans out in a more difficult setting. So we want to solve now this equation. This is Laplace's equation, I guess in the case f equals zero. It's called Poisson's equation in general. But you'll hear people these days saying Laplace's equation in both cases, I guess. But historically, that was the difference. This turns up everywhere. Physics, basically. Finding the electric fields with a specified charge density, there are ways you can, it turns up in fluid flow, it turns out in heat distributions. It's sort of just an extremely pervasive equation all across physics, so let's forget that now and just try and solve it. So let's jump onto here. What does this say? What's that symbol? Does everyone know what this guy is? It's just the sum of the second partial derivatives. And so jumping straight down to here, we see that what we're interested in is u hat of psi is the 1 over the norm squared of psi. So we have psi here as sort of some point in Rn, because we're doing this on Rn, okay? And dev hat of psi. And so this is a bit unfortunate. This guy here that we're meant to take an inverse Fourier transform of has a bad pole at psi equals zero. And isn't even L2. Okay, so this is sort of outside the world where we even know how to take Fourier transforms. So the idea here is let's try to solve this, a sort of slightly deformed version of Laplace's equation. We've put in an extra constant term here. And hope. We can take lambda to zero later. Because now the thing that we're meant to be doing is our p of xi inverse is 1 over xi squared plus lambda squared, which has no poles. And indeed, but we need more than just having no poles. I mean, if we're about to compute the inverse Fourier transform, we need to know that that's some L2 function. And sort of for two reasons now, let's specialize to R3. Now, one reason for doing that is just that P xi inverse is in L2, so there's some hope that we can even attempt this scheme and compute the inverse Fourier transform. Let's just quickly see why that is. I mean, this is a function that just depends on the radius. If you write, if you think about this in polar coordinates, this is just r squared, okay? And so when we do this integral, we're integrating, what is it, 1 over r squared plus lambda squared, and then we're going to square all that because we're working in R2. But there's also this r squared term because we switched to doing polar coordinates. Okay, that's the thing that we care about, being being finite, to see that this is in L2 of R3. Okay, but how does this go? Well, ignoring the constant terms, this goes roughly as, the constant term means you don't need to worry about a pole at R equals 0 causing the interval to blow up. You only need to worry about what happens at large R. But this thing behaves as roughly 1 over R squared, which you really can integrate. So that's fine. Okay. But it's not in L1. Because if we were working in L1, we wouldn't have that squared there. And as R went out to infinity, you just wouldn't have decay at all. Okay. So we've got this problem here that G of P of Xi inverse must be computed by approximating by Schwarz functions. Using this idea that to define the Fourier transform on L2, you approximate by Schwarz, apply Fourier transform to those Schwarz functions, and then you look at the L2 limit of those Fourier transforms to define what you mean. So we're going to have to do that bit of work. Okay, so that's one reason to specialize to R3. You end up in the world where you can actually do Fourier transforms. You might think about which dimensions that happens, which range of dimensions here means that this guy really is an L2 of Rn. But there are two other reasons. One is a fake reason for in a maths class, which is that we live in a three-dimensional world, so this is the most interesting case. You've always got to be careful with arguments like that, because other mathematicians in the math department will tell you we live in a 26-dimensional world, so you have to take these things with a grain of salt. And the real reason is that we're actually going to be able to do this integral in R3. If you follow through what we do, even if you work in other RNs where we're in L2, our argument's really going to fall apart. We're really doing a calculation that is somehow specific to the three-dimensional world. Okay. Fine. So, how do we approximate this guy, P of Xi inverse, by Schwarz functions? Always a good way. So what's the problem? P of Xi inverse is only decaying like 1 over R squared at infinity, but it's meant to decay faster than any polynomial, so we've really got to cut it off quite a bit at infinity before it becomes Schwarz. So what we'll do is just pick some function phi. All the positive reals, yes, real valued. Black and smooth, and let's ask that it's identically 1 on the interval from 0 to 1, and then it can do whatever it likes between 1 and 2, but then onwards after 2 it's just identically 0. Okay, so it's just some function that looks like that. Okay. And we're just not specifying what it does in between as long as it's smooth. Okay. So certainly if we look at phi of psi over some number r, which I'm just introducing right now, so this is just scaling it. So now it's identically, this function is identically 1 all the way out to r, times this guy, 1 over psi squared plus lambda squared. And that's certainly Schwarz. It really, really vanishes identically after a while, and it's a bit of a smooth. Okay. So, but even better than that, I think it's pretty easy to see that this converges to L2 as R goes to infinity to the thing we want. Okay, just because as R gets bigger, this function has the L2 norm of its tail, its stuff out past R, is going to 0 as R goes to infinity. And the way that this differs from, the way that this function differs from just this function, is just we've cut off the tail. Okay. That part is not so hard. And so that then tells us that, well, g of p psi inverse, by definition, is this limit as r goes to infinity. And so that's what we're going to spend the rest of our time trying to evaluate. So let's just write down the formula for inverse Fourier transform now. It will be some integral over R3D. And the very first thing we're going to do, perhaps unsurprisingly, is switch to polar coordinates, because obviously there's lots of radii sitting around in what we're looking at. So hopefully that'll make life easier. Let's just write out what we get. So that thing is now some function of x. And which function is it? It's this integral over R3, dvi x dot xi, and then this stuff. We're integrating over R3. So let's switch to polar coordinates. Keep that 2 pi out in front. Let's do the integral of r outermost. Lots depends on that. Phi of. I should have put here, all the way through here, I should have put absolute value of xi there. Xi, remember, is some point in R3. I meant to just be caring about the radius there. Sorry. Where is it? Oh, and now, of course, now that we're in polar coordinates, of course, we can just replace that with little r. Our radial coordinate. And then this is over r squared plus lambda squared. There's going to be an r squared from the change of coordinates into polar coordinates. And all that we've got left to worry about, well, is the integral over phi coordinates, and there's this integral over theta coordinates. And when we do the theta, we're meant to put a sine theta in there. So now we've taken care of doing all of the polar coordinate stuff, we're just going to remember this term here, okay? So what is this term here? Well, what I want to do is actually set up our polar coordinates. So let's say our vector x here was pointing off in some direction. What I'm going to do is set up polar coordinates, so x is the north pole. Okay, I'm going to use polar coordinates adapted to the vectors of x. And so, in particular, if I've now got some variable point that I'm integrating over, theta, which is usually the angle down from the north pole, is the angle between that point I'm integrating over, xi, and the fixed point x. Okay, so that means we can take this guy and write it in a pretty simple form. This becomes, it's just the dot product of two vectors, so it's the length of x times the length of xi, which is r now that we're in polar coordinates, times the cosine of the angle between them. Okay? But to get that, we needed to do this choosing polar coordinates adapted to the vector x. So now we just have to do some integration for a little while. And the first bits are pretty easy. So that bit is just 2 pi. This bit, we should pretty obviously take u equals negative cosine theta So the du becomes this bit here, sin theta d theta. And so this whole bit becomes what? When theta goes from 0 to pi, negative cosine, I guess, is going from minus 1 to 1. Sounds right. And then we've got e to the I length of x r minus sine u du. That seems like a very reasonable integral to do. When we integrate this vector u, we'll get a 1 over this stuff. That's I over x r. And then we've got to look at this at 1, this at minus 1. So it's e to the minus I x r minus e to the I x r. Okay, fine. Let's maybe just rewrite all that, because we did make some progress there. It's we've done all the integration. It's just now, well, we've done all but the R integral. It's down to one variable. And so we should stare at that.
Scott, why is it only from 0 to pi to 0 to 2 pi?
So remember in polar coordinates, you've got an angle phi that's going around the North Pole, and that's the one that goes from 0 to 2 pi. It's the one that's telling you your longitude in the world. And theta is going from the North Pole just down to the South Pole. So it's going from 0 to pi. So theta equals 0 is the North Pole, theta equals pi is the South Pole, theta equals pi over 2 is the equator. Okay, where were we? We were just rewriting this integral. Let's see what we got to so far. Okay. Let's see, there's a bunch of crafty stuff out the front. I want to swap these two terms over, so I'm going to put an extra minus sign in to let me do that. Let's just collect all the craft out the front. There's minus 2 pi to negative 3. There's an I. There's a 1 over the length of x. I think that's all the constants, and then we just have the integral from 0 to infinity of all the stuff still depending on r, which unfortunately there's a lot of. There's phi of little r and a big r. There's r squared plus lambda squared. That little r in the denominator can cancel with one of the r's there, so let's just have it times r. And then we've got these annoying exponentials. Just as another little trick, notice here, what are we doing? We're integrating, well, there's all this graph times this term, and then we're subtracting off this stuff times this term. But notice this term here is just the same as this, but with a negative sign. Okay. So just on this term, let's just do a change of quarter. Let's change r to minus r. And that term will look exactly like that term. The minus sign will come out from the dr. And we'll be able to write this as a single integral. Still the same stuff out the front. But now we can write it from negative infinity to infinity. Of just one. So that's a nice trick. Okay. So now we have to stop and remember some functional analysis. Yeah, not functional analysis. Other subject that we're not doing in the moment, complex analysis. To see how you do this integral. So let's have a quick crash course in complex analysis. So the point of taking a course in complex analysis is that it tells you the following. It says that if you do a contour integral, which means we're integrating not along some interval of the real line, but along some path in the complex plane, some function of a complex variable, let's say that this is did you guys see the word meromorphic? Or
yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So it's a function that's analytic, so it satisfies the Cauchy-Riemann equations everywhere, but it might have some poles as well. Okay. Then you can always calculate this guy as the sum over poles of f. So you look at each place where this function f has a pole, but you only look at those poles inside gamma. So gamma here is some path in the complex plane. Maybe the function has a few poles. And what you do here is you write down, so let's say the poles, what are good names, zi of f. You look at the residue at zi of f. I'll say what that is in just a moment. And then I can never ever remember, do you divide by 2 pi I or multiply by 2 pi I?
Multiply.
That does seem more reasonable. Yep, let's multiply by 2 pi I. Okay. So in fact, we can even just squeeze a bit of room for it out there. So it's just the sum of the residues with this extra factor of 2 pi I. Now, roughly, what is a residue? Well, near Zi, we can write f in the following way. We can write it as a sum from I equals d to infinity of some scalar multiples of z. Oh, we should write f of z. Yeah, f of z. Z minus zi to the d. Okay. Now, if our function was actually analytic, then what we could say is, well, f of z is equal to its Taylor series, and you'd get some expression like this that started at d equals 0, some constant term went up. But in the general case where there are poles, d might be negative. Okay, there might be some negative terms. So e.g. we might have f of z equals 1 over z squared plus 7 over z plus 3 plus 15 z plus dot 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 dot. Now you say it's a pole of order d, if I guess we start at minus d. So you look at the most negative exponent that appears here. So this function here has a pole of order 2 and 0. Okay? And finally, the residue at zi is just c minus 1. That is the coefficient there of the 1 over z term. Okay? So the things blowing up even more actually turn out not to matter. You just need to keep track of the first order component of things blowing. Okay. Did I get that right? It's been a long time since I did complex analysis. Okay, good. Why is this awesome?
Then you can integrate stuff in the real plane if you wish.
Yeah, you can integrate, you can do crazy integrals by just adding up some numbers. Awesome. Adding up a few numbers is usually much easier than doing integrals. So, when faced with any integral that you can't do, you want to be like Richard Feynman and do a quadruple integral, ideally in your head if you really want to be like Richard Feynman, but we'll settle with doing it slowly and gradually on the board. This one is maybe, well, I don't know if you can do this one in his head. It's dangerous to say things. Okay. We know, however, that we want to use this idea. But we're doing this integral. And that's the wrong sort of integral, okay? This is an integral all the way across the real line. Cauchy's theorem. Oh, yeah, of course. Cauchy's theorem. That's what this is.
Just checking.
Yes.
Your path should be a loop, right?
Yes, and I should have said a loop.
Inside.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. And you should decide at some point what you mean by inside, like maybe like the inside region. The loop is an oriented loop. Maybe the path is the stuff. The inside is the stuff you see on the left of the loop, or something like that.
Yeah.
So if we oriented this guy, that would count as the inside of the loop. But if we oriented the other way, it would be the outside. That's fine too. Okay, so we've got this integral here, and let's see, where does this thing have poles? Not so bad. This is an analytic function. That's as nice as you want. This is an analytic function. This is kind of terrifying. We can't do anything with that at this point, okay? Because it's just a smooth function. Cauchy's theorem definitely doesn't do.
Sorry, nothing in there looks like it's going
to
be like
poly. This guy's got a pole at plus and minus I lambda.
Oh, I'm sorry.
This is a real integral at the beginning, but we're about to try and interpret it as if it were a contour integral here. So we've got to be. So looking at this guy, there are two things to worry about. We know nothing about this guy, so Cauchy's theorem just doesn't apply. So it feels like we're just barking off the wrong tree at this point. And this guy has poles at plus or minus I lambda. Okay. Well, so this is great news. It means that if we can manage to turn this into a problem in complex analysis, there's basically only going to be one or two poles we need to worry about, depending on how we set up our contours. But this is a real problem, and also the fact that this is a closed loop, it's just some path that Cauchy's theorem doesn't apply. So the idea is, show as R goes to infinity, this approaches a contour integral. So approaches, maybe let's spell this out, in L2 of R3, and I'll even write out like this. Like this whole gadget here is some function of x, okay? This inverse Fourier transform. So what we want to argue is that actually this thing we're trying to compute, as R goes to infinity, in L2 with respect to the variable x, approaches some function defined by a contour integral. But even more importantly, it's going to have to be some contour integral where we don't have to worry about this bit, okay? Because that's not even meromorphic. How can we manage that? Well, this function here, remember, is identically 1 on the interval from 0 to 1. So it's identically 1 as long as little r is less than big R. So if we can do this sort of approximation by some some contour that's sort of inside the ball of radius R, gamma, we're going to use something much simpler than that, then life will be great, because this part will then just be identically 1, and we'll be able to apply Cauchy's theorem to get the rest of the way. So, that's going to take a bit of work to make that happen. But in some sense, it's all downhill from here. We have the idea how we want to use Cauchy's theorem. We just need to make it happen. So, one, of course, doesn't want to use silly contours like this. Let's actually just try and show that we can calculate this integral instead of letting R go to infinity as a contour around this semicircle. Okay? And then it's going to have exactly one pole inside the semicircle and exactly one out. To apply Cauchy's theorem. So, step one is to show that, how do I rewrite this? Do we have a name for that thing so far? Let's name all of this. The x, but I sort of want to think of it as controlled by some parameter for each different r. We might have some different thing there. Okay.
So what we want to do is write the x r as this terrible notation as v1 x r plus v2 x r, where this is an integral over where r is less than big R, and this bit is an integral where r is bigger than R.
Okay, and then show.
This guy goes to zero in L2 with respect to the x parameter as r goes to infinity.
Okay, so we're going to break it up as a bit like this plus a bit like that. And what that's going to achieve is it's sort of going to get us halfway to there. It's going to say this integral from negative infinity to infinity actually might as well be calculated up to an error term that vanishes as r goes to infinity by an integral from minus r to r.
And then write v1 of x r as then what we're going to do is write the contour integral around this contour from minus r, the semicircle from minus r to r, of the same integrand.
So notice, I mean, as soon as we've done this, the phi is going to disappear from our integral. We no longer need to worry about that. Okay. So we're going to write the contour integral of all of this stuff, but without the phi.
Well, that's just the same as the integral from minus r to r of all that stuff dr, plus the not quite contour integral. It's still an integral in the complex plane,
but it's just over that upper semicircle
of that same stuff dz, and let's call this stuff w of x, and r is still a parameter telling you how that behaves, and show w of x, this parameter r, goes to the zero function as a function of x, as r goes to.
Okay? Does everyone see the goal? We're replacing this integral over the whole real line with up to an error term an integral over just minus r to r, and then replacing that up to another error term, so replacing this up to an error term with this guy, the contour integral around the semicircle. Yeah.
Is there any good reason why beforehand you could think this is a good idea?
Yeah, it's just contour integration is such a good idea that any time you're faced with an integral you can't do, you know that you have to turn into a contour integral, however much work that feels, because it's going to be fine after you've made it into a contour integral. That really is the motivation. Like, you just have to do integrals by contour integration. This is the only tool we have for computing hard integrals. You can sort of, I tried to describe the steps here in a way that makes it clear that this approach to the problem actually has relatively little to do with the function we're actually integrating. Okay? Anytime you've got an integral over minus infinity to infinity, you can try and show that up to some error terms it's well approximated by just the integral over some finite interval, and then show that's well approximated up to some small error by a contour integral around a semicircle, and then do that integral. Okay?
I kind of believed you up until, until you just like, and W will get small too.
I think I was saying this same thing on Monday, that like, maths is hard. Out there are lots of statements which are true and important. So statements can either be, independently, they can be true or not true, important or unimportant, and easy to prove or not easy to prove. And we have to go for the intersection of all three of those. So sometimes you just have to think, this is the only way I can possibly prove this. So let's try it now.
Sure.
Yeah, let's go back now and start looking at the actual function we've got, and start trying to see why it feels plausible that these error estimates could actually work.
So I mean, yeah, maybe it would have been a bit more motivating to do that as well. So let's see. Let's look at this integral. So we've got two jobs to show. We've got to show that this goes to zero and this bit goes to zero. Let's try and understand how that can possibly work. It's actually kind of abysmal. And proving both estimates is hard. So I think I don't want to write it given how much time we have. It is at least this fact is in the notes relatively explicitly. This one is less explicit. So how do we see this? So it's kind of awful. Let's write f, a function of x, also depending on r, for this term we're trying to get rid of. So 1 over absolute value of x, integral over all the far away places, phi of r over r. One thing that we can use is that this integral here is certainly some convergent integral. And forget x for a moment. Take x to be any particular constant. Okay. Even if you can use the fact that this is just a complex exponential, so that's just a phase. This integral is certainly convergent. In fact, it's some constant not depending on x. So we can use that this is all bounded by that guy. Okay. On the other hand, we can do something a little bit sneaky and do integration by parts to get another bound that's useful. So here we're going to integrate this stuff and differentiate all the other stuff, that bit and that bit. And I don't really want to do it, but what I want to emphasize is that when you do the integration by parts here, you get a 1 over absolute value of x popping out when you integrate this guy. And then you can see that everything else that remains, and it's a whole lot of crap because you have to differentiate the product of all of those three functions there. So there's lots of terms when you do it. But, what it's not so hard to see is that all the integrals that remain are finite things that you can do. And overall now, there's a 1 over x squared at the front. There was the one we started with and the one we gained by doing integration by parts. And some horrible constant that is just there from doing integrals. And so then what you do is say, that guy, we can bound it. And this is sort of really awkward and not a sort of obvious thing. We can use both bounds that equals should have been an inequality. So we can use the fact that it's bounded by this first guy for, which one is it, for when x is small, and we can use that it's bounded by this guy when x is large. Okay? And those two facts together, now you can just integrate this piecewise defined function. And you can see that the L2 norm of f squared is bounded by, you have to go through and do this, but it's some yet another constant that we're not bothering to keep track of, times r inverse. Okay? And you just get, I'm not going to bother doing that now, but I claim that this is a sort of easy integral. We know how to integrate these functions. We can just do the integral and just watch where the r's all pop out, and you get that. And so that goes to zero. Okay, but it's kind of messy. But I mean, it's not so bad. I mean, you just have to, and obviously to show that some function has L2 norm going to zero, you've got to find some things you can upper bound it by that have L2 norms that more obviously go to zero. And so the real trick here is realizing that, well, when x is, if x is, yeah, well, I don't know very well how to tell you that trick is, using this trick is inevitable. I don't think it's inevitable. That's clever. Okay. And perhaps let's just say, and similarly for the upper half of the Cauchy integral, you do it. It's actually much easier, I think. There, you don't have to do any of this crazy splitting into pieces stuff. Okay. So immediately after we've erased Cauchy's theorem, let's use it. And so this tells us that the limit as r goes to infinity of v.
That's not what you wrote.
Great, thanks. Of this thing that we're actually trying to compute is all these stupid factors. But then we pick up a factor of 2 pi I, because we're using Cauchy's theorem. And now we just need to work out what the residue here is. How do we do that? Well, this bit's gone away. Remember the work we'd done, we were out in the region where this was identically equal to 1. So we're just looking at the function z over z squared plus lambda squared e to the minus absolute value of x z. Okay? And we're saying this has a pole at z equals I lambda. And we have to work out what that is. Well, how do you do that? I mean, it basically comes down to doing sort of partial fraction decomposition. Yeah, you write this as, you can write 1 over z squared plus lambda squared as 1 over z minus I lambda, z plus I lambda, and then we know that we can write that this for some a's and b's, which are probably very easy to work out. They're probably 1 and minus 1, something like that. This thing doesn't have a pole where we're looking, so we can just ignore that in computing the residue. And then finally, this is just a simple pole, and so all that we've got to do to work out the residue is take a times the value of z at I lambda times the value of this guy at I lambda. And I claim that I didn't actually write down what the residue was. I jumped a step here. The claim is you get this. Okay. Which is amazingly simple, given all of the mess that we just went through. So what does that tell you? Now it's just a matter of sort of rewinding way back to the beginning. This is telling us that the solution to this is just given by convolving this function that we just found with our original f. So it's just 1 over 4 pi integral over r3 e to the minus lambda x minus y over x minus y times f of y dy. Okay? Now that's all well and good, but of course we're out of time almost, and this wasn't the differential equation we wanted to solve in the first place. We wanted lambda equals zero. Can you take lambda equals zero in here? Well, no, you're really completely out of luck. The problem is, well, these these U's aren't likely even in L2. So there's no sense in which we could take a limit as lambda went to zero of the solutions to these equations and get some convergence in L2 and argue that that limit was a, the limit of the U's was a solution to the equation with lambda equals zero. So the thing that's in the notes, which I guess I'm not gonna have time to say at all, is the following idea, that if you assume f has enough derivatives, so C2, and vanishes at infinity, this inhomogeneous term here, you can check directly that this guy with lambda equals zero, so that's the very simple, this guy really is a solution. So it satisfies minus lambda equals f. And roughly the way that you do this is you just try, so this is some function of x, you just try to differentiate. And notice actually this integral here, this integral is just a convolution, okay? So you just try and verify this equation. You apply it, you hit this with two derivatives. You worry about whether you can bring it inside the integral. And there you can't, because this guy's derivative has a bad pole and it's the derivative of this guy isn't integrable again. So we run into trouble. But because this is a convolution, we can rewrite this as 1 over y, f of x minus y. So all the dependence on the x variable is inside f. And f, remember, was nice, okay? So that, by rewriting the convolution the other way around, you write convolutions, then you can bring the derivatives inside. And almost a full page later of dealing with messy integrals, you verify that this really does work out. But there's not actually a direct connection between what we proved here about solutions to this equation and the fact that this solves the equation we really want. Okay, we better stop there. See you guys on Friday. The assignment is due Friday. I'm in my office for office hours Friday morning, I guess. If you want to come by for last minute desperation then, feel free to send me emails. Questions or asking to come by at a different time. Please submit the assignment by email, so I don't need to shuffle bits of paper around. Tech is preferred. Yep.
Will you reply that you've received it?
Sure. I'll reply that I've received it. Okay. That sounds good. Anything else?
In like question 3 or something, it says, here's some, here's a bounded linear operator. I don't need to prove it's bounded then. Right? Just covered all my bases.
Which question?
You introduced, like T and Z, the question you talked a lot about.
Oh, yeah.
You introduced them as bounded linear.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, no, you're allowed to. Yep.
Yeah.